The question is, what are your thoughts about near-death experiences that people have? Should we put any stock in them? My thoughts, my feelings. I've never had one, so I don't know how I feel about them.
You ever had thoughts?
No, I try to avoid them. No. Scripture talks about people that have visions of heaven. We know that Paul spoke about the man that went to heaven. I believe that was Paul. I believe that was that time that happened was when he was stoned and they left him for dead. I think he got a glimpse of heaven and God said, it's not your time, you need to come back. But he was also told not to divulge the great things that he had seen. The thing that I think is the most important, I've heard a lot of different stories from near-death experiences. I've heard stories that seem to ring true with Scripture. I've heard stories that completely deny Scripture. My thing that I would say is this. If what their testimony is in line with Scripture, then I have no problem with it. But if in any way it denies Scripture or runs contrary to Scripture, I have a problem with it. Now, we know that God can do whatever God chooses. He's sovereign. He can reveal to whomever whatever he wants. And if he chooses to reveal to one person something that he has not revealed to us, we can't stand in judgment on that person, especially if what they are saying is in line with his word. But if it does not line up with his word, then I would say we have to be very cautious, because I was talking with Dave about this. And one of the things that he had commented is one of the near-death experiences that he had heard about. This guy just, he felt like there was no judgment in heaven, that God was welcoming to everyone and everyone was going to come in, and even the sinners who had not repented were going to be forgiven, and that's not scriptural. And so whatever it was that was putting those thoughts in that man was not God. Because God's word is very clear and it's very specific that there is one way to enter heaven, and that's through the blood of his son. So my thoughts are this. If it lines up with Scripture, okay. If it encourages the body and it lines up with Scripture, okay. But if in any way it does not line up with Scripture, throw it out. Don't listen to it. Because we have an enemy who is known as the deceiver. And he wants to come in and he wants to try and pull the wool over our eyes. I mean, wouldn't it be a great thought if there was no hell, everybody got to go to heaven? That takes all responsibility off of us to live godly lives. We can do whatever we want because we're all headed for the same place. But God says, no, I am a perfectly just God. Perfect in my justice. And because I am perfect in my justice, but I am also perfect in my love, I have made a way that we can be considered righteous, and that's through his son. That's it. That's the only way. So, you know, we need to remember, we're the pot. He's the potter. He's the creator. We're the creation. He chooses how the program works. We respond to his choices. So that's my thoughts on near-death experiences. I have one other question, and actually there's two others. There's only one other I'm going to address today. And the question given to me was, will children go in the rapture? And I pondered this and I studied this, and here's my answer. I don't know. Scripture is very clear that the one way to salvation is through Jesus Christ. But they have not, children, infants especially, have not reached a point where they are intellectually capable of making a decision. So here's where I stand on this. I trust God. I trust God that he knows what he's doing and that in his perfection, he takes those things into account. I trust that I'm not him, because I don't know those things. I don't understand those things. But I know his word says that heaven is only gained through the cross. It's only gained, we are saved by grace through faith, not of works. But I trust God. I look at my grandchildren, I pray for their salvation every day. I pray for the salvation of my grandchildren. But I trust them into God's hands. Until that time where they make a confession and an acceptance of him, I'm trusting them in his hands. So there's two of them. Next week we've got another one that's going to take a little bit longer to explain but I'm kind of excited about it. So, Dave, yours is here. Ben, yours was on a text, so that's what you get. If you have your Bibles, open with me to Romans, the book of Romans. We're going to go to Romans chapter 6. I thank you all very much for your prayers. Actually, before I get into this, there's some acknowledgments that need to be made. I would like to say a huge thank you to Dennis, to Steve, and to Matthew for stepping in while I was out with the viral thing and then with the surgery. You guys stepped up to the plate. It is a tremendous relief to me that we have godly men that can come and can give the Word of God in a timely and an appropriate fashion. That I can trust that when I can't be here, God has put things in place that the body is still being taken care of. So for the three leaders that stepped up and for those others that also kind of filled in while I was gone, I want to say a huge thank you. I have heard nothing but good things, that things went well and the messages were very on target, very well received. So thank you, gentlemen, for stepping in and covering for me. One of the things that I have been struggling with, and I struggle with this often, is that the church in America is so weak, so anemic, so frail. And we have allowed our culture to so insinuate itself into our Christ-likeness, our Christianity, that a lot of times we're having a difficult time sorting out what is godly and what is cultural, because there are things that are good that are not godly. You understand that? There are things that seem right to us that are not godly. Okay? And I've been really discouraged. I read a lot. And I read stuff about churches across the USA and things that are going on. And I'm reminded of a number of scriptures. Jesus tells us that many are going to say on that day, "Lord, Lord, did we not?" And he's going to speak to them. I mean, they're calling him Lord. They're thinking that he is, they're acknowledging what is right, but they are thinking they are in a good place. And he's going to say, "I will tell them, surely I never knew you. I don't know who you are." He also tells us that the way that we go is narrow and few walk upon it. But the road that leads to hell is wide, and many are those that are on it. And we see a lot of things in churches in America today that are not godly. They are not Christ-like. And I see portions of the church, sometimes large portions of the church, embracing these things that are not of God. They are not scriptural. They might be good, they might be well-reasoned, they might be well-intentioned, but they're not of God. And I see the church embracing it and having such a difficult time discerning what is different between Christ and culture. Now Christ, we should be taking Christ and trying to infuse him into our culture, but sometimes we have taken our culture and tried to infuse it into our Christianity. For example, in America, We admire, we appreciate the rugged individualism that our Constitution guarantees us. We have rights, don't we? The Constitution guarantees us certain rights. And the founders of our country were very wise in the way they made this, that we are a constitutional republic. Okay? We're not a democracy like a lot of people say. Study your history. We're a constitutional republic. We are, the difference being a democracy, the majority wins, and the majority gets whatever they want. Well, that could change from year to year, and there's no stability. But a constitutional republic guarantees that the rights of the individual are guaranteed despite the rights, the rule of the many. So whether your political party is in power this season or not, your individual rights are guaranteed and safe. The problem with that is, though, because we have these rights, that there is no man that in any way can assert himself over us, as in other types of government where you have people that have absolute power, we struggle with lordship. We struggle with submitting ourselves to the headship of Christ with the idea that we would be beholden to anyone. And so when it comes to being a Christian in America, the culture that we're growing up with this idea of independence, really is very much at odds with the dependence that Scripture tells us we need to have. First and foremost on God, and then on each other. Okay? Because we're not independent. We are not called and designed to function without other people. We have been called and placed into the body of Christ, which He is the head. So He gets to choose how it goes. And then we're there to work, to complement, to help each other. And then, but we have this idea that you know, leaning on someone indicates weakness. Yes, because we're weak. We have areas of weakness sometimes we're completely oblivious to. There was one day after my surgery that I tell you, they had me doped on drugs. So I didn't feel a lot of pain, but the drugs were making me sick. My head was spinning. If I kept my eyes open, the room would spin on me. And I tried to get up and move, and you thought I was walking on a ship at sea. I'm looking at Christy, and she's shifting on me. And she's looking at me like, what is your problem? I said, I'm not having the problem. You're the one that can't stand still. You know? And so I needed help at that point with just getting some things done. And thank God that Christy and Thaddeus were there to help me get those things done. But in the body of Christ, we are called each with a purpose, each with a function. But the way those purposes and functions work is in complement with each other. Okay, so that it meshes and that it works the way that it's supposed to. And this idea that we're independent, that doesn't fly in Scripture, folks. It doesn't fly. We have needs, we have hurts, we have wounds. And the body of Christ is supposed to come together to minister to those hurts, those wounds, those needs, those failings. And so I look at these things, and I've really been, my heart breaks, because we used to be a nation that sent people out into the world to bring the gospel. And now we receive more per year coming in to bring the gospel. They say anywhere from 80 to 85% of this country claims to be Christian. And yet look at the state of the country where more is better. All I need is just a little bit more. And the God of the dollar has every bit as much of our attention as the God of eternity. And it wounds me because I see the church embracing these things and at best just being passive and not resisting, not putting up our hands and saying, no, we are called to be a perfect, spotless bride without blemish. And yet we accept things because that's the way they are. And so I was reading through Scripture and God kept bringing me back to Romans chapter 6. So we're going to look at Romans chapter 6 today. We're going to spend a little bit of time here. Because the thing that I don't want me, as the pastor of this church, to be ignorant of the fact that you might be struggling. Because we come into church and you know, a year or so back, I had Christy share a dream that she had about the masks, these giant masks that people had, and they would come in, and when somebody would talk to them, they'd turn and they'd present the mask, and that's so devastatingly true. We come into church and we put on our perfect little Christian faces because we don't dare risk people finding out that we sin, that we make mistakes, that we're not perfect, because then we come under judgment. I don't like being under judgment. But the judgment from God is a loving judgment. It's a judgment to help you through these things. And the church should be loving in judgment just the same way that we love through these things. So I want to read Romans chapter 6. We're going to read the entire chapter, and then we're just going to go back, and I'm going to pick out a couple of spots that I want to kind of address as I feel like God has been leading me over the last couple of weeks. I'm going to actually start up in verse 20 of chapter 5, just so we get an understanding of where Paul is at here. He says, "Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Now Paul is going through and he's giving one of the greatest treatises on Christian theology that we have in the New Testament. And he's doing it in a very concise manner, believe it or not. He spends about five chapters going over this idea of the law, sin, and grace, and putting them into their relative position so that we can understand how this whole thing works. Because Paul is teaching that no man can be saved by the law. Okay, we can't, because none of us can attain to the full measure of the law. Not one of us is capable of meeting every point of the law. And if at any point you fail, you've broken all of the law. And so God, in his infinite mercy and wisdom, has provided for us a sacrifice whereby we might be inheritors of grace. Okay? And so where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So what he's saying is that grace trumps sin. Okay? But now we get into the Christian living. Okay? What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. Okay, I can't stress to you enough the significance of those three words. By no means. In the Greek, there is no clearer way to be so adamant about a point than the words that they use here. It is almost as if Paul is shouting, "No! Do we sin all the more? No!" Okay? That's how important this is to him. Okay? How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Okay, so here he comes with his rhetorical question. He's kind of circling right back around. He says, what then? Are we to sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? No! By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourself to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, either in sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teachings to which you were committed, and, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification, and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay. So here's the exposition that I want to get to you today. Okay. This is something that we have got to be foundational in our understanding. This is a foundational principle for Christianity. And if you don't master this, all of the walls upon which you build your faith are going to be weak. Okay? First, everyone has sinned. Everyone sins. 1 John and James both tell us that there is no one without sin, and that we all stumble in many ways. Okay, so there's no one without sin. So right there, get this understanding. You sin. I sin. We sin. Okay? We all make mistakes, sometimes willingly, sometimes ignorantly. Sometimes we're not even aware that what we're doing is a sin. That's part of why it's so vital to, with the leading of God's Spirit, read His Word, that He might instruct us so that we can go, oh, I didn't know that offends you, God. Forgive me. Tell me to step back from this. Let repentance, turning away from. See, the thing about sin is that the first thing you have to become aware of is that you have it, that you do it, that it has infiltrated you. It's insinuated itself into your thinking, into your living. So, sin having done that, God provided a way whereby we might be considered righteous, that we might be considered holy, that we might be sanctified. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us that it was Jesus Christ, that He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God, the very righteousness. He took our sin and nailed it to the cross. So when you come to the cross, you have to understand that you're coming as a sinner. Somebody that is abhorrent and repulsive to God. That by your very nature, you are an enemy of God. And if you come to the cross with any other attitude, you come trying to make a compromise. And this is where I am so concerned about the church today. We have this idea that we can come to the cross and negotiate a peace agreement with God. That we can broker terms. Well, God, I'm going to come and I'm willing to accept your eternity with you in heaven. I want to cash in on the gold harp. And I'm willing to give you these things. I'm willing to let go of these areas of my life. I will give them to you. I'll give up my Sunday mornings. I'll give up an occasional Wednesday or Thursday evening. I'll negotiate. And we come in with this. We come in with this attitude that we can negotiate with God. His answer is no. Absolutely not. By no means. Because any part of you that you keep, that you don't come and have nailed to the cross is sin, and sin separates from God. When we come to Him, we have to come all in. All in. We get to keep nothing back. See, that's the whole idea. When we come to be crucified. We come to die. We join Him in death that we might also join with Him in resurrection and life. So I want to hit some key points here that Paul is making. The first thing, we're all sinners. We all come by sin to the cross. Okay? After the cross, we still sin. Paul makes that clear by our natural selves. We stumble. We make mistakes. We still have bad thinking. We still have patterns of behavior that God is going to work out in us. So at one and the same time, we are instantly considered sanctified before God because of the blood of Jesus Christ. But then that Holy Spirit comes in and begins the process of sanctifying us that we might live holy lives. And He starts convicting us of those things that we didn't realize were sin. Okay? Those things that God says, I can't have any part of that. Okay, that's the one of the reasons that the Holy Spirit was sent is to make us aware that we've got to change. So the first idea that we need to grasp on here is we got to die. Okay? And when you die, you have no rights. You relinquish all of your rights upon death because you can't argue your case anymore. The very best you can have is a will that the lawyers and the family members and others will try and interpret what your plan was. But if they opt to throw that away and do whatever they want with your stuff, you can't do anything about it. You're gone. You have no rights. So the first idea is that we have to understand death. Okay? We have to die that we might receive life. Okay? We follow Christ in death that we might follow Him in resurrection and life. So the idea here, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? Now, that sounds kind of ludicrous, but actually I think a lot of us kind of have this idea that we can continue in sin. It's not like we're not going to say, well, I'm just going to have my way because it's covered by grace. But really, that's kind of how we live a lot. I know I shouldn't do this, but I know God's grace supersedes my sin. The problem with this thinking is this. That sin was a part of a person who died. See, the difference between a believer, a Christian, who's been resurrected into new life, and a non-Christian, is now with God's power living inside of us, we can choose not to sin. We can choose to not sin. This new life that we have been resurrected in, this new life that we have been created in, has been created spotless and blemish free. But we have to choose. I just want to make sure that wasn't God wanting to interrupt. We have to choose to live a sin-free life. Now we go, well, nobody can do that. Well, we choose. We're all going to stumble. We understand that. But we cannot embrace sin. We cannot excuse sin. We cannot reach a peace agreement with sin. God will have nothing to do with any agreement in sin. One has to go. One or the other has to go. Either the sin goes or God goes. Now, I'm not telling you that this sin will keep you out of heaven. I believe His grace covers that. But I believe that as a new creation in Christ Jesus, you have got to dedicate your life to allowing that sanctification process to work, working with the Holy Spirit. Oh, we're not saved by works. No, but we are called to works after we're saved. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. That we might do those works that He created beforehand for us. Okay? One of those works that I'm absolutely convinced about, folks, is that we have got to wage undying eternal war with sin in our members, in our flesh, in our body. See, this is the thing that I don't want, I don't want to become ignorant, because I know you guys and I love you guys. I don't want to be ignorant of the fact that you might be struggling. See, I can look at the general Christianity in America and I can see the struggle. I can see that sin has come in and woven its way in, and those things that we have reached an accord and an accommodation with our culture, that God says, no, I have no accommodation with this. I have no accord. What can light have in common with darkness? Where there is light, it drives out the darkness. There's no gray. It's perfect light, or it's not. I heard about this movie, and I guess it was a book called 50 Shades of Grey. If you have watched that movie, shame on you. That they would glorify that garbage. I cannot believe, I don't know a lot about, but what I heard has absolutely filled me with disgust. They have bastardized love. They have demolished what love is supposed to be about. And that horrifies me, because there are believers in the church today that are looking and chasing after that stuff, that think that's romantic, and that just horrifies me. One of the things that we have got to do, and God has been working through me, and this has been a long process for me, because he has started weeding out those things that really do nothing to honor and glorify him. And we've had to go through our movies repeatedly. Actually, we do several times a year. We go through movies and we look at a movie and we go, can't watch this one anymore. We got to lay this one down. And movies that I used to think were great, all of a sudden I can't watch anymore, because I start hearing these things that are just so offensive and vile. And I go, wow, how can I subject myself? How can I subject my family to these things? I can't do this. I've got to set these things aside. So let's get back here. For if we have been united with him in death, like his, we shall surely be united with him in resurrection, like his. We know that our old self, you see, this is the idea that we have to have, is that guy is dead. He's gone. The patterns of behavior are there and need to be worked on, but that person no longer lives. And we cannot function and live and act as that person any longer. He doesn't exist. She doesn't exist. So we have to take on a new persona. And thankfully, what is that new persona? It's not me. It's Christ in me. And that's, well, so what would I unite with Christ that would any way add to him? Nothing. There's nothing in this world that I can add that would in any way add to Christ. So then if I add anything, what would it then do? It would diminish him. Are you willing to diminish Christ in you? But we do. Every time that we tell him, no, I will not, or yes, I will, and it's outside of his will, we are diminishing him in us. Every time. And you go, oh, this isn't a real big deal. I'm not killing anybody. I'm not. There's lots of people worse than me out there. It's not about them. When you stand before God, he's not going to ask, okay, so which one of them was worse than you? I'll send them to hell. He's not going to set the bar at your level and say, everyone below it, out. The bar is set at the level of Jesus Christ, which is perfection. And the only way we get to stand before him and in any way receive commendation is because of Jesus Christ. So why would we do anything that would diminish Christ in us? Folks, we got to die to ourselves. And sometimes that is a long, agonizing, painful, excruciating. I like that word. Do you know what excruciating means? Excruciatus. It's from the cross. coming out of the cross. We use it to describe the pain of the cross, excruciating, but it means out of the cross. And that excruciating pain, that sin being worked out of us. And we cannot reach an accord with sin in any measure in our lives. Now, you say, but how do I, I've tried. Confession. You know, one of the things that really makes me sad is that church has become a place of profession and no longer a place of confession. And we profess a lot of things in church. We profess the good things that he's done. We profess our prayer requests, and we profess the answers to our prayer requests, and we profess a lot of things, but we don't confess. I have been a pornaholic since I was about 6 years old. I've struggled with pornography since I was 6 years old. We lived in naval housing, and the guy next door to us, he had stacks and stacks of girly magazines in his garage. And every time he went to work in the summer, all the kids in the neighborhood would go, and they'd look at it. And I remember my brother giving me a magazine, and I looked at it, and I thought, what in the world? What in the world is this? I don't understand this. Now, thank God, he has worked and worked and worked, sometimes excruciatingly, in me. First, to convince me that it was sin. I had to be absolutely convinced in my heart that it was sin, that I might be grieved enough to ask him, to beg him, to plead with him to work it out of me. Not just a shame because, oh, you know, culture looks down on this, or I don't want people to catch me. I had to be convicted in my heart that it was sin before God and an abhorrent offense before him before I could get to that place where I would plead with him to come and deliver me. Now, I still have to have things in place so that I don't slip. I have accountability partners that at any time, day or night, they can come up, look at my phone, look at my iPad, look at my computer. I have people that I call if I'm struggling, if things are happening. I have to watch what my eyes see. You know, I have to be very careful what comes on TV. I have to be careful even with the stupid advertising signs up and down the highway. I have to be careful because any one of those things has the potential to spur me. Now, I thank God that he has delivered me for a long time. He has kept me safe from this. But I'm always aware that the potential is there. And I take steps to guard against it. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 was one of the things that God really spoke to Christy and I. Because being addicted to pornography and all the different ways that screws up the chemistry of your brain and your hormones. I required that Christy be available whenever. And I was reading through, and God had convicted me of this, and I was reading through 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and it talked about taking a time apart that you may dedicate yourself in prayer to God. Well, I usually pray for about 15 minutes. So I can do that. But that's not what it's talking about. It says that you take some time apart that you might devote yourself in prayer, that the focus would be praying, not gratifying the flesh, but focusing on prayer, dedicating myself to my worship, my relationship with God. And then it says, and come back together again that you might not be tempted. Okay. And so Christy and I have had for several years, we've had a plan in place where there's a particular time that we take and we separate for a while and we dedicate ourselves to prayer. And I tell you what, that was hard, 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 hard for the first probably year and a half that we did that. I struggled and the enemy wanted to come against me and wanted me to start, you know, just a quick peek won't hurt anything, you know, it's okay. Everybody has needs, and everybody has, no. Because the whole point of this time is I'm not gratifying my flesh. I am dedicating myself to working on my spirit, to building on my relationship with God. And I have to work at it. Even though to this day right now, I don't feel the temptation, I don't feel the struggle, it could take a very small thing to start that over. So I keep my guard up and I keep myself protected, and I have people that have come around me to help me with this. And I'll tell you, one of the things, gentlemen, if you have been addicted to pornography or you browse pornography, you have to make that right with God first. You have to make it right with your wife. Because I had to confess to Christy my sin against her. Because the pornography, she was just an object when it came to issues of intimacy to me. Because the way my brain had been so wired, she became an object. And I had to repent before her. And I had to confess my sin to her, and I had to repent, and I had to start trying to allow God to redefine my thinking when it came to intimacy and marriage. I'm not there yet, but I'm getting there. I'm getting a lot better than I was. I don't know that I'll ever get there till He take me home, but I'm going to get better and better and better. So we can have no accommodation, we can reach no accord with sin. Because we have died to sin, we have been made alive in Christ. So, verse 10, for the death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. See, this is the idea that we're talking about. Let me read verse 11 real quick. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. See, this whole idea is that you are no longer bound in sin. It no longer has hold over you, but you have been created in new life to Christ Jesus. So this life, this person that we are, is set to live a life of righteousness that can only come about by the Spirit of God living in us. Now, the first thing, let me say this to you real quick, okay? Because I know we all struggle with sin. Okay? I'm not struggling with that particular sin, but I have others that I struggle with. Okay, and God pops new one to my mind occasionally. He says, oh yeah, to see this? Yeah, that's sin. You need to stop that. Oh, okay. This is impossible without the Spirit of God living inside of you.
Amen.
Okay, so I don't want to tear you down and make you feel like this is hopeless, because it's not hopeless, because God has sent His Spirit into the world first to make us aware of sin. And I gotta warn you guys, we become so callous to certain areas of sin that when the Spirit starts speaking, we go, la 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 la, I'm not listening, la 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 la, and we go on. We have got to watch for callous areas in our life. Because see, when the Spirit starts speaking and starts prompting us, if we don't address the situation, if we don't turn and start working on the situation, it's just like anything that rubs on you over and over and over and over again. It becomes callous, and it becomes hard, and you lose the ability to be sensitive in that particular area. But when the Spirit, when you give, you get into line and then you get into agreement with the Spirit of God, now, when you step into that place where He has called you, you know, you're walking along like this, and He says, no, I need you over here. Or sometimes He says, I need you way over there. When you get in line with that, He gives you what is necessary to accomplish the deed. Now, in the moment, it's hard. It's hard because we are, our that dead self, that pattern of behavior is screaming for attention. It wants to be satisfied. It wants, doggone it, it wants McDonald's McNuggets. Story behind that. In 1999, I had surgery. And for about 14 days, I didn't eat any solid food. And for about 10 of those days, I got no food at all. I was just on IV stuff. I don't like McDonald's. I've never been a fan of McDonald's. French fries are about the only thing there that are any good. Although Thaddeus has kind of got me hooked on the apple pies now. But I just have never, you know, the kids, every year on the kids' birthday, we'd let them pick where they wanted to go to eat. And the two choices that they most often picked were Taco Bell or McDonald's. Don't you want Victor Steakhouse? McDonald's. But I was laying in the bed, And it had been about, I don't know, 8 or 10 days since I'd been able to eat anything. And I was watching TV, and McDonald's came on, and it was Chicken McNuggets. And they crack open then the McNugget, and the steam comes out. They dip it in the sauce. And the sauce gushes up over the McNugget. I'm thinking, oh, I love McNuggets. I don't even know what's in there, but I love them. I don't love McNuggets. I don't care about McNuggets. I'd be just as content never having another McNugget in my life. But man, in that moment, oh, Lord, God, heal me enough to get a McNugget. Just one. Let it steam as I open it and dip it into the sauce. But that's what it's like in that moment when sin is pressing it hard on us, and that flesh is rearing its head up, and it desires, it is strident in its desire to sin. Now, God has said in His Word, I was talking with Scott the other day, we were talking about this, how, you know, God has said in His Word that He will never put more on you than you can handle. He always provides a means of escape that you might endure, that you might stand. There are times when I know when I've been struggling with a particular issue, my temper, when I could feel it, I'm standing at the threshold, and that little feather is coming, and I know as soon as that feather touches me, I'm going off the edge. And I see Christy with the feather going. And I know in that moment, in my head, I can rationalize, God, You have said that You will provide a way out, that You will give me what I need to endure. But I have to choose to accept it. You know, when we were going through the fruits of the Spirit, I got into the habit, when I was struggling with a particular thing, that I would quote the fruits of the Spirit, and I would quote them over and over and over again. I've gotten to the point now where I quote certain other scriptures. For example, the last 4 or 5 days, I've been quoting the 23rd Psalm, especially at night when I'm laying there and my mind is really restless, and I've got all these burdens that I'm praying for, and I start to feel despair. I start to feel anxiety going, God, I can't fix these. I can do nothing here, God. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. You preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And all of a sudden I can, okay. And it'll start to come up, and I just start it over again. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And I'm sorry it's in King James, I learned it when I was a kid. I looked it up the other day because I had two of the verses reversed and it wasn't sounding right in my head, and I looked it up in ESV and the whole thing was wrong. There was not a thou, there was not a thy, there was not an est, and I couldn't. So I asked Christy last night, I said, do you know the 23rd Psalm, can you quote it? And she quoted it, and she quoted it. And my brain had to work to make sure that she was actually getting, she could be making things up and I wouldn't know. But I gotta tell you, in that moment of struggle, in that moment when you're standing on the precipice, when you're at the edge and that feather is coming, God has promised He would make a way out. We have to accept it. And it's not that He didn't say it was going to be easy. He didn't say, oh, this is a bit, you know, I'm just going to make it just to go, I'll go poof, it'll all go away. He never said that. But He said He would be with us in it and He would provide a way. We have to choose and we have to discipline ourselves. Even as Paul says, I abuse my flesh. to make it do what I want it to do what I know it needs to do. I abuse my flesh. No, you are not getting your way this time. For me, I start quoting scripture, or I start singing worship songs. And sometimes I mix all my worship songs together and I create a new song. Because my brain runs so fast, I get halfway through a verse and I jump to another song. In a different key in my head. But we've got to understand, people, that we are at war. Everybody wants to declare war against the devil, and absolutely, Ephesians makes it clear that we're at war with him. But I tell you what, there's an enemy much closer to home that we're at war with, and that's our flesh. Amen. It's those patterns of behavior that have developed over the course of our life that are totally contradictory to the Spirit of God. And the only way that we can overcome them, we've got to come to the cross. We've got to die at the cross. We've got to be resurrected in new life. We've got to allow his Spirit to work in us, that new life might be lived out in us, that we might become a people of God, that people would look at us and they would know that we are his by the love we have for one another, by the manner in which we comport ourselves in our daily lives. Anybody can walk here in church and go, oh, they must be a Christian. Oh, they must be a Christian. But do they see, are they able to get that same determination when you're at work or when you're in a place and things aren't going well and things aren't at their best? Are they able to look and go, wow, that person must be a Christian? Father, we bless you this morning. Father, I am overwhelmed by how gracious you are to us, how gracious you are to me. I thank you, Father, that you sent your Son, that his perfect life might be given in exchange for my imperfect life, for my total chaos and wasteland, Father. Father, that in my life you have put springs in the desert. You've made a way in the wilderness. I thank you that the desert blooms now because you have come into my life. I thank you that your Holy Spirit has come to teach me, to convict me, to show me where I'm wrong, to strengthen me, that I might know and do the right. And I ask, Lord God, that you would be with us today. Father, where sin has come in, I ask that you would reveal it. Father, that you would strip away those calluses, that we might with tender hearts feel the prompting of your Spirit. That, Father, with firm constitution, we would plant our feet and we would stand firm against the onslaught. That the sin that desires to come in, we would reject. That we would stand firm. And that, Father, in that moment of desperation, when all is black before us, we would call out to you. That we would cling to that rock. That we would hide under the shadow of your wings. And, Father, we would find deliverance in our time of need. I ask, Lord God, that you would make us a church without masks. That we would be a people that are transparent and open and honest before you. And I ask, Lord God, that with this transparency would come strength, encouragement, steadfast love. And I ask, Lord God, that you would accomplish these things not for our good, but for your sake, Father. For your sake. That, Father, we might be a people that pleases you. With sensitive hearts, with open ears to hear what you would say, with firm mind to do what you would call us to do. We bless you and we honor you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.